All right, welcome, welcome, welcome. We're going to try something here a little different. It's very similar to the previous video, Appeasement of Cosmic Destruction. We're going to go over this material again. It starts out pretty rapid, and it tends to smooth out as it goes along. So just hang in there, and kind of kick back and maybe eat some snacks, just relax, and see if your mind can follow along with it. We jump from here to there to here. We're kind of jumping around. Just kind of pick up stuff like that. And I know it's not easy. I know it's a strain and a stress. And things will smooth out more and more and more. But I want to meet the urgency of the times by doing this type of video. So I'm going to now see if we cannot join the talk in progress. It might be slightly in progress. It's not a problem. Not a problem. We're talking about the attempt to appease cosmic destructivity, which is at the real core of human consciousness, our psyche. And it's at a very deep level. We're not aware of it hardly at all. I've been aware of it most of my life, actually, in the very fact of making an effort to look at this. It says wonders about you and your capacity and willingness to get it. And it's not that difficult. It is not that difficult at all, really. And the effort to do it, at some point you will just say, oh yeah, that's easy. I understand that. So here we go. It's about 57 minutes or something. And of course there's a little bit of unevenness, but that it's all live. It's all part of the gestalt that we have. So let's go there. Let's try it.
Wonderful, wonderful. Let's continue on with our great path of awakening to the opportunity to sidestep cosmic destructivity. It's very important to note that non-judgment doesn't have any narrative to it. How could it? When we first think about non-judgment, we say, okay, that's great, and everything is wonderful. But where's the narrative? Okay, where's the story? Let's say we had the vision of non-judgment. And we say, well, everything's perfect. But then we start looking around. Okay, now what's happening? Where's the story? And then you'll feel like, well, we're missing something. We can't see where the story is. We're missing it. There is no story to non-judgment. There's no story. There's no narrative. Also, there's no destructivity to it. So we're also looking, okay, everything's perfect, but when do the bad guys show up? You say, okay, where's the signs? We're looking for signs. Okay, like when we look for signs for cosmic destruction, we are aware of the various signs. For instance, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be in those days. Meaning, before cosmic destruction arrives, people actually have an intuitive sense it's coming at a deep level. They just consciously, at the conscious level here, we tend to deny that, ignore it. So we pretend we don't know what's going on. Some people who have a very sensitive access to the deeper levels of consciousness are aware of it, that it's coming. But most people know. However, they are aware. They are aware, and so they are preparing for it. They're preparing in various ways. So there's various indicators that it's on its way, depending on how the global community acts. And several of the signs are that there's a lot of emphasis on just trying to deny it, that it's coming. So now what do we do when we deny something terrible is coming? We do the flip side and say, hey, let's celebrate. I mean, let's just all, you know, have a great time. How do we do that? Oftentimes people get into singing. The global community will be very much into singing. Singing contests, singing this, singing that. Oh, let's just all, lots of music, lots of singing, lots of dancing. Okay, lots of partying, lots of food, into all that kind of stuff, which is, those are the great distractors. But when we tend to, for instance, when we tend to feel very anxious, what do? We tend to eat. We tend to eat, or we tend to listen to music, or we tend to dance, or we tend to sing. Those are basic indicators that there's something deep within us that is frightening us. If it becomes kind of a, and we know that this is what's been happening, is the mania over dance contests, over singing contests, all the interest in food, food channels, and just so much interest in things that dampen down our anxiety. Okay, so those signs have been there. That's what it's meant. As in the days of Noah, so shall it be in those days. As the cosmic destructivity nears, we have an intuitive sense it's nearing, and we start acting out in certain ways to try. First of all, we try to blot it out. Say no. I'll just sing, eat, dance, and be merry, and that should take care of it. Now, the other phases are people start setting up for global sacrifice to start. Well, even before that, the machinery for global control comes into place, wherein we think, well, the dancing and drinking and feasting and all that didn't do it. We still worry. We feel like something dangerous is coming. So they say, let's everybody get on the same page. Okay, let's get rid of all the wickedness, the evildoers. Let's everybody get on the same page so we can say, look, we're all functioning very well. There's no inequality, nothing bad here. We say, well, let's get rid of anything bad. Let's get rid of it. As if to, we see, we tend to think that this destructive, cosmic destructivity has some kind of rational mind, some kind of reason-based mind. It does not. It does not. It's not like that at all. And it's just also a figment of our imagination. Also, by spirit, not human consciousness. We, spirit, is imagining all of this. But this force of destructivity doesn't have any reason, rhyme or reason to it all. It's all, this dream is an eccentric whim. There's no reason to it. So this aspect of the totally eccentric whim of wanting to be prime creator on the part of spirit, it doesn't have any reason. You cannot reason with it. So we think that we're hoping, hey, maybe we can reason with it. Maybe we can show that we're doing a good job. Maybe we're just being punished for not doing right, etc., etc. No, it's got nothing to do with being punished for not doing right here. Not in that context at all. So there isn't anything we can do to stop it. But anyway, the preparations, we try to get iron out all the bad stuff in society, as it were, anything we can think of. Let's just, and the important thing is everybody on the same page. Now, once that fails, and these are overlapping phases, there is the phase then the world gears up ahead of time for global sacrifice, which is once the cosmic destructivity gets close, we realize, wow, it's not stopping. We say, okay, let us start carrying out the destruction. Let us turn destruction on ourselves. Let's be self-destructive. And hopefully that will reason. It will understand that type of language, the language of destruction. It'll say, ah, they're destroying themselves. Well, I don't have to come here and destroy the planet. They're destroying themselves just fine, so I'll leave them alone. That is the rationale we use, the wishful thinking we use. Trying to find a way. Human consciousness has always tried to find a way to bargain with this cosmic destructivity. And basically, our basic premise is that bargaining with it is possible. That we feel we have to have that basic premise, else we'll go completely insane. We'll be able to live a life of total anxiety. Well, not quite true. Because I realize it cannot be bargained with. Now, I have lived a life of anxiety up to this point very badly, because I had to see what other options there are. But certainly, we will never discover those other options if we keep thinking that cosmic destructivity can be bargained with. It cannot. Once we accept, wow, it cannot, then we'll look for other options. And of course, the option is to sidestep it. Get out of its way. Of course. Don't try to bargain with it. Get out of its way. I mean, you know, truth, the only difficult part about truth, coming to truth, is you get so angry at yourself. Why? Because you think, why? It's so simple. Why didn't I think of this before? And we get angry at ourselves and kick ourselves, saying, gosh, so obvious, so simple. It's just unbelievable that I didn't see that before. And so really, when you see the truth, there is a period where you just feel really disappointed in yourself. See, I took all this time just to see this. I could have seen this years ago and saved me all the suffering. So there is a time when you get down on yourself, when you have these insights, actually. It's not like euphoria, like, oh, I had this, oh, now I see. No, it's like, what an idiot. How come I didn't see that before? It's, oh my gosh, that's unbelievable. That's the kind of reaction I get. It's understandable, too. Very understandable. Because it is very simple. It's just common sense. It's just basic. What, if you can't bargain with something, what do you do? Get out of its way. That's, and of course, we on this planet, now see, in the past, we could go to a, like if there's just localized disasters, we could go to some other place. For instance, there have been droughts throughout history, and people would migrate. There have been great, great migrations throughout history based on massive droughts, where literally the whole population of an area, most of it, would just leave, abandon it, and start traveling. And they just travel until they came somewhere where they could get some food, which then usually caused wars because the people with the food didn't have enough to handle this huge influx of refugees, really, from the drought. And, of course, that would create severe conflict, understandably so. Understandably so. People come in, they try to take the jobs, try to take the food, try to live up, use the infrastructure that all the other people have worked so hard on, and massive problems. But anyway, people move around this planet, have always moved around this planet to deal with the destructivity on localized levels. What if, though, you get a planetary destructivity event? Cosmic destructivity that involves the entire planet, and that does happen, and that's what we're looking at coming up. Where do you move to on the planet? Not many places. Not really. The only place you could really think of going is underground, which there are some with the means to do that who have actually already planned all that out, excavated, and have underground cities actually ready for them. They're extremely wealthy. Those who have access to the machinery to tunnel boring and excavating underground equipment, it's very sophisticated equipment they have. They've already done that and are continuing to expand in that way underground. Now, I don't know if that's going to really help them or not in what's to come, but possibly. But most of us don't have those means, and it's really, who wants to be a troglodyte anyway? So, the option is you have to get off the planet. That's the option. Now, it's not exactly a coincidence that at the end of World War II, there was this beginning of interest in UFOs. Now, UFOs have been seen throughout history because they're in the artwork throughout history. They've been put in artwork throughout history. So we know that ancient people, all throughout history, people have seen UFOs. And very common. And there have been large sightings throughout history, like whole cities seeing, you know, huge cylindrical, silver-like cylindrical objects in the sky. And so, but after the end of World War II, and especially with the Roswell incident, I believe it was 1956, there's a lot of UFO sightings. And this continued on and on and on and on and on all over the planet. So we're aware, the planet's aware that there are vehicles capable of doing things that we are not familiar with, that we don't expect to be possible. The speed, the fact they can disappear and seem to shift into some other hyperspace or something that we just, they can tend to skip across the sky so quickly and then disappear. So globally, we're aware that there is this advanced capability of transport, of flight. And that's been percolating through the consciousness of the globe for over 50 years now. So it's not a big continuity issue to say, hey, if we get off the planet, okay. I'm sure there's transport to get off the planet. It's not a problem. I mean, we've already sent people to the moon. landed rovers on Mars. You know, we can get off the planet with our technology. We're aware that there's technology that's way superior to what we have now, and it may not even be technology. Actually, the transport is done by spirit and mind, right mental focus, right mental clarity. It's done that way. It's beyond technology. It's actually something vastly superior to technology. So we can get off the planet. We absolutely can. Now, we say, well, this cosmic destructivity is coming through this solar system. Where are we going to go? The whole solar system is going to get whacked. That is true. However, there is the fact of multidimensionality, and that we could shift dimensions. And the cosmic destructivity cannot do that. It cannot shift dimensions like that. It's more linear. So there's that very real possibility. There's also, one could use hyperspace or some type of transport that jumps through time and space in such a manner that you could travel very long distances very fast and get out of harm's way easily to some other dwelling place. Jesus said that there are many, many, many mansions in God's domain, kingdom, many, many dwelling places in his mansion, so to speak. And he said, if this weren't true, I would have told you it wasn't true. So, and he said he's going to God's mansion to prepare a dwelling place for us, a place for us to dwell. That he's going to come back at the time of the, just before the cosmic catastrophe, to take us there. And said, you'll know the way there. Not a problem. So we have to begin thinking outside the planetary box, which for some, it never even occurs to them. But for others, it's been occurring to them for a long time. Say, hey, you know, why do we limit ourselves and say, this is the one and only, I mean, we used to think this is the one and only place in the entire universe that's habitable. But recently, we're now realizing that, you know what, there's probably a lot of habitable planets. Planets that have similar orientations to their sun or suns, and there could be myriads of dwelling places. So, it's not too difficult to consider these things. Not too difficult. We don't have to panic. We don't have to say, oh my gosh, cosmic destructivity is coming, and, you know, that's it. We're doomed. We're doomed. No, we're not doomed at all. We're not doomed at all. However, we do have to open our minds to what is possible. So if we do that, we're not in panic mode at all. We're not in panic mode. We're not in fear mode. We're in optimism mode and in encouragement, hope mode. A lot of hope, a lot of optimism that, yes, we can have a good outcome. So with that in mind, we're not afraid to look at this issue. Whereas those who think they see no possibility, whose minds are closed, boxed in by a very provincial outlook, they think, no, that's too scary. It just leaves me in dread to look at that. So some people won't be able to look at it. That is factual, absolutely. But a lot of people will be. A lot of people can say, hey, yeah, let's look at things in a wider context. That's not a problem. Now, as the cosmic destructivity gets closer, again, the various means are used to try and defend against it, and then you can start boiling things down to inflicting trauma on ourselves. And it's obvious that the world is very much prepared to do that. If it comes to that, the world is very prepared. I mean, the number of armaments in the world right now is just, you can hardly count it, right? So when people get freaked out enough, you see, here's the thing about the situation is that we believe, human consciousness believes that it's rational. It's really rational. It's on a rational footing. And the truth is that human consciousness is a very thin veneer over fear and instability. And we have to work very hard to maintain this thin veneer. So you can have a globe that acts very rationally up to a point, but it has a breaking point. Just like a thin veneer, we might like have a, let's say we have a board made of balsa wood, and we put some like an oak veneer on it, okay? That's kind of like humanity. And we're looking at that oak veneer and we're bragging, say, oh, look at this 2x4, oh, solid oak, wow. I mean, this thing can handle, you know, tremendous weight. It won't break, you know, real tough. But if we look at it carefully and say, now, wait a minute, that's just a very thin oak veneer. It's got no tensile strength at all. And underneath is balsa wood. You say, my gosh, this thing can't stand up to any weight. It's going to snap in two. So the world is really, human consciousness is very much like that. We have this rational veneer, and we like to boast and brag and think, hey, no problem. We can handle anything. We're not going to freak out over anything. Wrong. History shows this is not true. Now, what has happened recently is everybody's gotten educated. They've gone to through schooling, and they call it education. And we all collectively, globally assume that this thin veneer now it's really solid oak, that we've educated it to be unflappable. This is conceit. This is delusion. This is self-deceit to think that. There is nothing about the educational system, the education we get in this world, that turns balsa wood into oak wood, that has even touched upon this stuff. What we do is we've just tried to polish the veneer. Okay? So, again, use the analogy of the balsa wood and the oak veneer. We realized that the board was snapping. And we said, wow, we don't want it to snap anymore. So some people got together and they put their heads together and said, you know, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? And they said, huh. And they started thinking, well, you know what? Why don't we just put some wax, some varnish and some wax on the oak veneer and polish it up and make it look more oak-like? So that is what education does. Okay, the education of this world simply puts a veneer on the oak veneer, a varnish on the oak veneer, a varnish on the oak veneer, polishes it up, just polishes it up. And now everybody stands back and says, wow, look how that oak sparkles. Wow, that's some kind of beautiful oak. And they're taken by the superficial polish of the veneer, that they don't even bother looking to see that it's still balsa wood underneath the veneer. Believe me, it is still balsa wood, because the spiritual path has to do with actually changing the balsa wood into oak, as it were. So you have to actually look beneath the veneer, beneath the surface, and say, oh my gosh, well, this human consciousness is nothing but a fantasy. And it's a fantasy of destructivity. And it's just completely crazy. And we need to change hypothetical scenarios. And we need to understand where this all came from. And it's totally unnecessary. In other words, we need to get spiritual education. Not religious, spiritual education. Most religions have to do with trying to appease the forces of nature. And the various rituals and prayers, etc., as if the forces of nature have something to do with God. And so they believe that God sent this punishment upon the people, and that they have to figure out some way to say, I'm sorry, God, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, and we're trying so hard to behave correctly so you won't get mad at us again. Like a child in relationship to his parents. We really projected the parent-child relationship onto the hypothetical scenario that we're dreaming, imagining, as if God were somehow involved in it and we could control it by trying to, you know, appease the parent, calm this angry parent down, which, you know, it's futile, it's useless. But true spiritual education is very different than the education that we get, the secular education, and even the religious education. Very, very different. Entirely different. And in the videos that I've posted, I give you, try to share how it goes, how a real spiritual education, how that goes, trying to share my own process of doing that, share it with the world so they can see, get a glimpse of it and say, it's quite different. And you get the taste of it, kind of. You get the feel of it. And it's not a science, it's an art. It's an art. It's the art of determination and perseverance and courage and willingness and desire to get free of suffering, all of that. Tiredness, boredom of suffering, just saying, hey, I don't want this. I got to, for sure, find out how to get free of it. That is what drives it. And the willingness then to look beneath the pretty veneer of the situation. So when the cosmic destructivity gets close enough, closer, 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 at some point, it's like a heavy weight being applied to the consciousness. At some point, the consciousness snaps. It snaps. You know, so that is what we're facing in the world. We don't quite understand clearly enough what we're facing. We believe we're rational beings and we're very progressive beings, and our education has made us snap proof, and so we're going into this glorious future. And we don't at all acknowledge that this pressure of cosmic destructivity getting closer and closer is like an enormous weight, enormous burden on our psyche, on our consciousness. And that our consciousness is still as weak as balsa wood, has no strength to it at all, really. And when this worry gets close enough, we'll snap. Globally, the human consciousness will snap. And what does it snap? It snaps into appeasement mode, full-out appeasement mode. So you can have a very rational globe that's behaving in a very rational manner, almost overnight, suddenly snap and snap right into global conflict. Literally, that is what can happen, and is likely to happen. And people will just seem like they snapped. They just will seem like, yeah, this is the thing to do. All this talk about peace, 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 that we've been doing, hearing nonstop for quite some time. People saying, we gotta peace, let's everybody peace, let's love one another, let's have peace on the planet, let's all this stuff gone with the wind. As if it never was. As if it never was. I never paid attention to all this talk about love, light, peace, all this kind of stuff. I knew that was just braggadocio, because nobody's backing it up with the tough effort to uncover the real facts about the situation we're in. No, we're just airily talking about how important, how much we want peace. We want peace here in the world. We want peace. That's just, again, whistling past a graveyard. Braggadocio, kind of like saying, hey, we're not bothered by any cosmic destructivity. Look how happy we are. Nothing can touch us. So you have all those who saying peace, 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 peace. Suddenly they snap, and they're all for war. They're all for conflict. They're all for trauma. They're all for inflicting as much damage as possible upon others and themselves, so that they can hold this picture of devastation to the cosmic destructivity that's coming and say, hey, look, it's already happened here. You don't need to come here. It's like a psych out. It's trying to say, like, oh, you've already come here. Look, what you already did your damage here, so there's no reason to return again. You know, bypass us. It's kind of like a Passover type of situation where we're trying to con the destructivity into thinking it's already been here. That's a good way to look at it, actually. Another way is to say that, look, we're doing it to ourselves. You don't need to do it to us. Like, we're punishing ourselves. You don't need to punish us. Or we can say, look, you already punished us. Why we don't need to do it a second time. It's a con like that is trying any angle it can. So those are the two basic angles. And there's a third one, is we try to beautify ourselves and say, oh, how could you possibly destroy such beauty? That type of thing. So we tend to try and elevate the whole goddess type of thing into so many goddesses, so many princesses on the planet, and the princess will say, oh, no, don't worry, cosmic destructivity won't touch me. I'm a princess. You know, that. So a lot of people are being raised to believe they're princesses. And we think that's a defense against it, because how could the How could anything touch these princesses? You know, not possible. Of course, that doesn't work either with cosmic destructivity. It doesn't care at all. It wants to pulverize the planet into dust. It's so furious that this too has failed. It did not convince God at all that it's real. No, you see. So, God pays no... Prime Creator, again, had nothing to do with making any of this fantasy of impermanence. This fantasy of impermanence we call existence, Prime Creator has had nothing to do with it. Absolutely nothing. Prime Creator never has anything to do with hypotheticals or fantasy or dreaming or imagining. Nothing. Zero. Reality never imagines, fantasizes, or hypothesizes. Reality is real. So, God pays no attention to existence. None. None. Because it knows it's completely meaningless. No consequence to it whatsoever. And so God is not paying any attention to what's going on at all. Knows there's nothing real in dreaming. And so we cannot ever get any acknowledgement from God that these dreams are real. We're trying to get God to say, okay, this part of the dream is real. It's real. You see. And so the cosmic destructivity is both furious that what we've done hasn't worked, and it's hoping that the pulverizing of this planet will get God to say, oh, what did you do? You destroyed my beautiful planet. You destroyed all my beautiful people. How could you do such a thing? In other words, just get upset and acknowledge like it, that it's very consequential to God. No, that'll never happen. That'll never happen. But that's what's hoped for. That's what's hoped for. It's a vain hope. Entirely vain hope. So, we throw up our defenses. They don't work. And human memory, our consciousness, stretches back a long ways. Not only on this planet, but other places. And the consciousness of dwelling on planets, as it were, has a long history. And we should know that it doesn't work. It doesn't work. Stuff, bad stuff happens. No matter what we do, bad stuff happens. Destructivity happens. So, with that in mind, wisdom whispers in your ear saying, hey, don't try and deal with it. Don't try to bargain with this. Don't bargain with what can't be bargained with. That's foolish. Don't try to appease it. That's foolish. Instead, sidestep it. Sidestep it. Get out of its way. Get out of its way. And then we think, how come I haven't thought of that before? Get out of its way. It's coming, just get out of its way. It's so obvious. And yet this getting out of the way does need some rehearsal. You don't want to just do it cold turkey. It's possible. But why risk that kind of thing? That's the question I have. Why risk it? Because we're so busy running defenses and appeasement modes towards this future event that we don't spend any time rehearsing sidestepping it. Because we think, well, if we spend time sidestepping it, that's taking some time away from appeasement, trying to appease it. Or to try to psych it out, con it, say, you've already been here. You don't need to come again. You've already been here. Look at the planet. Look, it's in ruins. You've already been here. Surely you don't need to do more than this. It's like a fire break. It's like there's a huge forest that's all dead and dry, and you think, oh my gosh, lightning season is coming, and if we get a lightning strike, the whole forest is going to go up. So what we do is then we do a controlled burn in a certain area and do several of those so that no matter where the fire starts, it can't jump the area that's already been burned, so it can be contained. So it's kind of like that. We kind of say, let's inflict extreme damage on the planet so that when this cosmic destructivity comes, it'll kind of recognize that, wow, there's not really much work to do here. It looks like it's already been done. So, okay, let's not bother this planet. it's like somebody caught in a trap, get their arm caught in a trap or something, and they say, wow, if I want to live, I got to cut off my arm, and I got to sacrifice something to get free of the trap. Now, again, destructivity, the purpose is to make God take notice of it and say, wow, this is consequential. This is consequential. So what better way to try and... Now, what happened was, in trying to prepare for cosmic disasters, which have happened, hit humanity so many ways, but not as bad as what's coming now. This is going to be the worst ever. People thought, hey, this destructivity, well, the purpose is to get God's attention to that destructivity is real. Okay, that's the whole point. Make God say, oh my gosh, destructivity is real. I need to worry about that. So how, people thinking, they say, if we can convince the destructivity that God's already agreed that destructivity is real, we don't need any cosmic destruction to come here. And that will definitely save us, definitely protect us, you see? Because there's no more need. The necessity is gone. We've already succeeded. And so we think, okay, how do we do that? How do we do it? And they say, well, let's pray to God to send us something that God truly values, that in the destroying of this, God will truly be say, hey, you killed something real. You destroyed something real. Okay, and then we'll say, aha, okay, we finally succeeded. We don't need any more destructivity. So that is why the narrative of that we call the Christian narrative came about. We say, God sent his only most beloved son here so that he could be killed. So that God would say, what have you done? You killed my son. You've killed the most important part of reality, that my favorite part of reality. You've destroyed it. You've killed it. And then we will say, okay. Now, see, we've already succeeded. We killed something real. God took notice of it. God's recognizing it and saying, you did kill something that's real. That's consequential to reality. Therefore, we don't need any more cosmic destructivity. And therefore, we think we're saved. See, we're saved from any more cosmic destructivity. All we have to do is just accept that we did kill something, destroy something that was real. So that is the very clever notion that was dreamed up. Of course, it's complete nonsense, and yet you can see the cleverness to it. But you can also see the simplicity of it's pretty basic. We just want to convince destructivity that its goal, its purpose, has already been accomplished. Therefore, no more need for it, right? Very simple. Very, very simple, actually. How do we do that? Well, we claim that God willingly decided, okay, I'm going to have mercy on you. You're being hit with so much destructivity. I'm so sad to see that. I'm going to have mercy on you, and I'm going to actually give you something real that you can destroy. In other words, that's the thing that God made flesh. In other words, let's be honest, God made vulnerable to being destroyed. The key of Christianity is to say that God was made flesh. That is the absolute key. Without that, you have no Christianity, actually. At least the way it has been popularized. At least that way. Because if God wasn't made flesh, then the crucifixion of Jesus had no effect at all on cosmic destructivity. It was just, again, a sacrificing a symbol. It wasn't nothing that would be consequential to God whatsoever. However, if God could become flesh, in other words, vulnerable to being killed, and then that flesh be killed, essentially we're saying God was killed. Okay, we are able to inflict death upon God. Therefore, we have this destructivity already accomplished. And now all we have to do is work on overcoming it, which the resurrection magically, we say, oh, well, after we succeed, magically, we're going to have a resurrection. And that's our goal. Our goal is to be able to survive the annihilation of reality so we can become prime creator, R meaning spirit. So this, the Christian narrative is a magical solution to the whole situation. Totally magical solution. Of course, it doesn't solve anything at all. Because God cannot become flesh. God cannot become vulnerable. God cannot be attacked. God cannot be killed. Totally impossible. And again, God takes no notice of dreams whatsoever, the content of dreams whatsoever. We are just assuming that God has done all this. It's just a wishful thinking, a belief, assumption. Can never happen. So we have not solved the problem of cosmic destructivity at all. We wasted our time. The first thing you can do is sidestep it. Secondly, it can also be solved by just dropping this dream altogether. Drop the desire to be prime creator. There's no need to try and destroy reality. There's no need to try and get God to recognize that he's vulnerable to being destroyed. There's no need, no necessity to make death real at all. No necessity, zero. So the only problem we're left is a continuity problem. We don't want to drop dreaming altogether because we've been doing it for so long. We're kind of afraid we wouldn't know how to function otherwise. So we dream a happy dream, a dream where we don't need to try and make death real. We accept the blessing of God upon all dreams, which is this unconditional non-judgment, unconditional non-judgmental blessing, where there's equal blessing upon all dreams, no matter what the dream form, format, or symbol the dream is. It's all symbols. It's all meaningless, totally inconsequential, so it doesn't matter what the symbol is. The blessing blesses all dreams equally. In that instance, we can actually see dreams that are death-free, completely threat-free. And that reminds us of reality, the non-exclusive nature of non-judgment, where nothing is being accepted, excluded. Nothing is being excluded. That reminds us of reality. And then seeing dream forms that have no threat, never been threatened, never been harmed, can never be threatened, death-free, all this, that also reminds us of reality. And so with that happy dream, that this happy hypothetical, we can choose, it's up to us, the continuity problem is solved. The continuity problem is absolutely solved that way. And no problems. No problem. That's the real no problem, huh? That is the real one. Okay, so these are the things that people here tend to not look at. The helpfulness of anybody like myself who's spent a lifetime of willingness to look at this stuff is they can encourage others to do so. They can encourage others to say, hey, let I can do it. Let me just take a look at this. And see that, hey, yeah, that's just the whole thing is just a simple magic thing of trying to say the destructivity has already succeeded. That's just a little wishful thinking. It's just wishful thinking. It doesn't work. Wow, that doesn't work. So let's not waste time on that. Let's look a little deeper. Let's let go of all magical tricks, all magical wishful thinking, and let's pay attention to what we really can do. We can sidestep it, and we can choose a different dream where there's no destructivity whatsoever, none. So we don't have to work on appeasing anything. We don't have to work on conning anything, tricking anything, with magical rituals. None of that stuff. None of it's necessary. We simply abide and enjoy the remembrance of reality. That's all we need to do. So, in my case, something that I could speak of directly, I found the world has not been interested in what I can do, what I can do here, because they think it's a waste of time. I don't seem to be helping them in their what they're doing, which is appeasement and trickeration and wishful thinking and magic and all this kind of stuff. I'm not interested in it. I'd say, no, that doesn't work. And they don't like that. They say, wow, what do you mean it doesn't work? We need to make it work. We need to use your intelligence to find a way to make it work. That's what I always get. How come you're not using your intelligence the right way? And I say, ah, but I am. But I am, but I am, but I am. You see? So, I am using my intelligence properly, and always have been. It's just that people don't see it that way. They don't see it that way. And it's been an uphill climb to get anybody to recognize that, that the willingness and the capacity to honestly look at the situation and objectively report what it is, and to contemplate genuine solutions, practical, what actually works, that's an invaluable asset to have. Unfortunately, the world doesn't recognize that. So I'm still continuing to climb this uphill battle. It's really something. And the problem is that you get into a situation where you get into a scapegoating situation. Well, people will suddenly decide, hey, let's make one exception here and let's get rid of something. We have to exclude something. So let's exclude this one who's completely at odds with what we think is helpful. Let's exclude them. And that's a concern I have. If you try to speak out and you don't have any backing, then you tend to run into this kind of scapegoating scenario. So that's something that I have to look at. And it is worrisome, because there definitely is that tendency where people will gang up on you and saying that, hey, we can succeed in our wishful, magical appeasement rituals if we get rid of anybody who says we can't. It's that kind of, again, magical thinking. Magical thinking uses magical solutions, always. So magical thinking thinks, huh, how come we're not succeeding? Says, hey, because somebody doesn't agree with what we're doing, that's the cause. They think there's cause in that. In other words, that somehow somebody just saying, well, I don't think this is going to work, is somehow causing it not to work. It's interfering with the magic. You see, those who rely on magic always think something's interfering with the magic. Always. That's why the rituals get so complicated. Because it never works. And they think, you know, I must be doing something wrong. Let me just jump up and down 20 times and say this mumbo jumbo and turn around 15 times and then go bury this pot in the ground and then sit in a certain posture and chant for 20 minutes and that doesn't work. Say, well, okay, let me add another step to it. Let me add another step and another step and another step. Never works. They just keep adding more and more complexity to it. And then arguing over each other, like, wait a minute, what part of the ritual is not working? What part am I not doing right? See? All of you, a complete waste of time. Complete waste of time. They never spend their time saying, wait a minute, maybe it doesn't work because it doesn't work. That's why it doesn't work. Maybe it doesn't work because I'm not looking at the thing from the level of causation. Maybe it doesn't work because I've misidentified the problem. Okay, that has to dawn on people. They say, wait a minute, maybe I've misidentified the problem, which is why the solution is to a misrepresented problem. That's why I'm not solving the problem. I still have this fear. Why? Because the problem's been misrepresented. That's why. We misrepresent the problem to ourselves. And again, in continued efforts to try and trick God into thinking that symbols are somehow real. But God cannot be tricked. Cannot be tricked. So it's futile. Even if it were tricked, it's still a trick. It doesn't mean anything. It's not real. Symbols are never real. Hypotheticals are never real. Excluding one thing is not non-exclusion. It's not non-exclusion. It doesn't remind us of reality. We think that we can be reminded of reality just by excluding one thing that doesn't agree with us and everybody else agreeing, and that will solve the continuity problem. No, it won't. No, it won't. Remember, the continuity problem is solved by no exclusion. Vision of no non-exclusion. That means not anything being excluded. That is how it's solved. Okay? That's the only way it's solved. Making one exclusion is exactly the same as making infinite exclusions. No difference whatsoever. Because reality doesn't make any exclusions. That's its nature. It's seamless. It's whole. It's indivisible. The notion that reality can be fragmented into two parts is the same notion that it can be fragmented into a trillion infinite parts. No different. No different. So the notion that, hey, let's exclude just one person, one fragment that we don't like, and that will solve the continuity problem, and then we'll be able to escape destructivity. That doesn't work. Doesn't work at all. Scapegoating doesn't work. See, that's another way we try to solve the problem of destructivity. Let's escape it. Let's drop this idea. Let's solve the continuity problem. How do we do it? Scapegoating. Let's make one exception, and that should solve it. See, that's a delusional remedy, an egoic remedy to the continuity problem. Because the one that they're excluding is the one that's telling them the truth, saying, hey, you can't make any exceptions. And of course they say, oh, no. We need to make an exception. We have to say this one exception, this is a symbol that's real. See, this is the symbol that's real. All else is not. All else is symbolic. We could drop that. But this one, no, it's real. This fragment. This is a real fragment. This is a real fragment. That's what we're saying, which is, of course, completely opposite of truth and still maintains the whole idea of making symbols real, making death real, and then overcoming that. So that's also futile. Scapegoating is futile. So I won't be scapegoated. I'm not interested in being scapegoated. I know it's futile. But there's certainly a tendency, an overwhelming tendency in the world to do that. So again, human consciousness is not rational. It is not rational at all. It's really magical. It's based on magical thinking. And that's why human consciousness has always missed the mark. Missed the mark. Missed the solution. Missed the remedy. Continuously. Continuously. And I see no signs of that changing whatsoever right now. No signs. I really don't. I don't see any sort of big movement of actually looking through the eyes of reason at saying, what is the problem really? No, I just see more attempts to polish the veneer. That's it. So there is no, I don't have any optimism at all that there's going to be some big global movement. Everyone's going to drop their magical thinking. It could be that there are those who have been working on this here and there, and there can be a big global movement to harvest those. Harvesting means getting out of harm's way. For those to solidify their will to get out of harm's way, that is possible. But certainly, we cannot expect that everybody on the globe is going to just one day wake up and say, oh, okay, I get it. That's not how it works. It's not how it works, because one has to really have a familiarity with this position and have sort of worked through all the non-factors, because we believe there's so many factors that consequences and factors based on our false magical thinking, and we haven't taken the time to work through and see that all those are non-factors. We haven't seen that's all a non-necessity. It's not enough to just to kind of superficially grasp a notion, a concept. We have to see that this, the non-necessity of all other solutions, all other remedies, it's not enough to say, yeah, this would work. We have to see that all the other stuff can't work, doesn't work, can't work, and there's no necessity to it. So there's more to it than just hearing what works. We also have to accept the other stuff doesn't work. Plus, we have to recognize that the force of habit, the force of familiarity, all that stuff keeps us hooked into what doesn't work. Can't embrace what doesn't work and what does work both at the same time. They're going in opposite directions. How can we embrace them both? You cannot. We cannot do that. We can't have one foot on the platform, one foot on the train when it's time for the train to leave the station. We can't both board a plane and not board a plane and expect to, when the plane takes off, we're going to get to our destination. It's not possible. Jesus said you cannot be loyal to two different masters. You'll end up being disloyal to both, which is no good at all. So let those who have worked at it, let them be harvested, let them accept stepping out of harm's way, and be very viable to help others anytime, any place that they're willing to be helped. But certainly the voice of reason is within everyone, so it's not like people are without comfort or reason at all. Everybody has reason within them. It's not like you have to have some guru to tell you what's true. It certainly is helpful to a certain extent, but ultimately we all have the reason within us. Nobody is without it. So the notion that people are trapped with no help is not true at all. It's not true at all. The Holy Spirit is with everyone until the very end, until everyone is finally exchanges hypothetical scenarios. The Holy Spirit is there to counsel and give wise orchestration and counsel to them accepting the exchange of hypotheticals. No, nobody's excluded. Nobody's excluded. Nobody. There can never be any exclusion. Nobody. Again, reality is non-exclusive. Doesn't exclude, make any exceptions. Reality is real for all reality. It's not just real for part of reality. Real is just not... the real is not partly real. It's totally real. Totally real. No exception. No part of it is unreal. No part of reality that's unreal. And these are things that are very helpful just to hear and say, I hear that. And again, hearing it is the first step. And then recognizing that saying that part of reality can be unreal, you have to let that go. And all of the problems that go with that, you also let those go. And you recognize the non-necessity of holding such a concept, such a fantasy, is no necessity to it. We keep thinking, well, there must be some necessity to it, otherwise I wouldn't have held it for so long. That, again, that's not using reason. That's a lack of reason. It's plausibility. It's using plausibility. Say, well, I don't know for sure if it's necessary, but I'm just going to assume it is because I've been holding on to it for so long. I certainly wouldn't. Why would I have held on to this for so long if it wasn't necessary? You see, we don't examine it. We just say, okay, let me save time. This is just a reasonable assumption. Let me make the assumption and go on to the next thing. Say, no, can't do that. It's too crucial. It's too crucial for us to make an assumption about. We try not to make assumptions on the path. Try to avoid that. There's some things that we can assume, but we still have to then use that assumption to look at it. We say, okay, I assume that looking at this is going to be helpful, therefore I will look at it. That's the right use of assumptions, reasonable assumptions, plausible assumptions. It's to say, okay, that's a reasonable assumption to make, and I'm going to look at it. So that's what we're doing here. We're saying this is where we need to look. This is where we need to look. And if you have to assume it, in other words, go on faith, that's okay. But just don't make assumptions that we don't need to look and say, I don't need to look at all at this. Okay, very great. That's it. Wonderful, wonderful. Let's continue on with our
Zen stick. You awake? Everybody's falling asleep. Zen stick. Zen stick, Zen stick. Wake up, wake up, wake up. I need to apply the Zen stick to myself. Oh, look out. Wake up, wake up, wake up. A lot of good stuff in there. I enjoyed listening to it, actually. And hopefully this didn't freeze up. And it's still going, but it looks like it may have frozen up. I don't know why. Hey. Yeah, if you can grab some stuff out of there, if you can catch the rapidity of it, if you can kind of get into the realization that it is possible to, right in the day as you're functioning, going about your day, that it is possible to think in this way. I mean, this is an example of how I think during the day, every day, is I go over this stuff. Going over this stuff is absolutely possible. And when you get tired, Zen stick, come on, don't slack. you can use your day in this way, going over stuff, checking it out, saying, hey. Uh-oh, didn't have the mic on. Okay, Zen stick to myself, my gosh, Zen stick. Hey, we all get tired at times, right? So, anyway, this is an example of what we can do during the daytime. Anytime we can work on this stuff. What I was doing, just stream of consciousness, just work on stuff. That sounds loud. No, it's not. Okay. Yeah. And you can bounce around. There's no test. We're not testing anything. You can bounce around from here. Tie this in. Okay, over there. Okay, over there. Okay, over there. Build a gestalt, a totality. At least open up to it. Open up, say, okay, keep widening. I can go here, over there. Yeah, let me see the whole territory. The territory gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And you become comfortable with this large territory, thinking outside the box. And it becomes easier and easier and easier. It's called right use of mind, right use of time. Okay, right use of mind, right use of time. Global Challenge 2013-2016. Is now. It is now. And so I'm just showcasing what is possible as you go about your day. You can. Now, if you're in a situation where you need to interact with people, you can use affirmations, which I have been doing. And it's possible to use affirmations even in the most intense situations where you're expected to be socially active. You can use affirmations. Like truth is true right now. Truth is true right now. And you're talking to somebody, and then in between words, you can say truth is true right now. You can slip it in like truth is true right now. In a second, just remind yourself truth is true right now. Right now, not judgment doesn't need this next instant to judge. It doesn't need to judge this next instant. This next instant doesn't need to be judged. And this next instant doesn't need to be judged. This next instant doesn't need to be judged. And you can slip those affirmations in, and then when you're not so engaged, you can. Work on clarifying, expanding your comfort zone into wider and wider, outside the box type of considerations. This is the time we're in. It's global challenge, right use of mind, right use of time. Okay, it is possible. I'm just saying, yeah, showing you it is possible. So it's not impossible, and it's very helpful. Okay, well, how do we do? 1 hour. One more Zen stick like that, and another. And thank you for watching. Appreciate all the viewers. And we will keep on going with some extraordinary stuff. And again, the best is yet to come. It really is going to get much, much better in many ways. Okay, that's it for this one. Zen stick.